Welcome back. Today is the afternoon section. We will have two talks, one long and one short. And the first one is the long one, and our speaker, which is Alessandro Viani, as you can see, is actually preparing himself. Okay, the mic is on. You can come here and start talking. Okay, so today we'll talk fast about a hierarchical model for Bayesian inference of brain activity from magneto-electroencephalography. Okay, there you go.
Sorry, can you have something in order to change the slide? I would like also to give it to you, but you can touch the screen. Ah, si, si.
If you want. If you have a lot of slash pose, maybe it's not the best thing.
Yeah, I have some slash pose.
And let it be a lesson for everyone there.
I'll be faster than today.
Yeah.
Thank you. What I'm talking about is hierarchical models for Bayesian inference of brain activity from magneto-electroencephalography data. And the plan of the talk is to solve in a full Bayesian approach the MEG inverse problem with a specific Monte Carlo algorithm called SMC samplers. And what I'm focusing on is the introduction of an identifier in that model in order to make it independent from one of the input parameters. And then we'll see some performance analysis and some results on the synthetic data. Okay, but just focus a little bit on what MEG is. MEG is a non-invasive medical imaging technique whose focus is the reconstruction of the brain activity having measured the electric for the EEG and magnetic for the MEG field outside of the scalp and with some sensors. And so the data is the magnetic field for the MEG and the electric field for the EEG. And how can we measure it? Because inside of the brain there are a lot of neurons, and when stimulated, one neuron generates a current flow. And this current flow, as everyone knows, generates a magnetic field. So we can measure both the electric field or the magnetic field. It depends on what you want to measure. Of course, the intensity of the field generated by only one neuron is not enough, is not strength enough for being measured outside. But the brain is made in such a way that when stimulated, thousands of neurons are stimulated and are activated at the same time and roughly in the same direction. So we can measure outside the brain the superposition of these fields or these intensities. And here you can see, for example, the sensors outside the scalp that are made in that way, so are rounder. They are called SQUID in Italian, that is S-Q-I-D in English, I don't really know. But the fact is that we can measure the superposition of all these fields. And even if thousands of neurons are activated at the same time, the field generated by the brain activity is not so strong in compared to the other magnetic fields we live in. For example, the Earth magnetic field is more than 10 orders of magnitude higher than the one produced by the brain. Okay. But the problem now is how to modelize the brain activity. So that there are neurons, they are activated, etc., etc. And there are two different ways for modeling the brain activity. The first one is the dipolar model, where we modelize the brain activity as an unknown number of sources characterized by two points. The first one is the position, because we discretize the brain with a lot of voxels, and then we say that the dipole, so the active region inside the brain is located in some position that here is R, that is the index of the box. And then we have to say how strong is the brain activity. So here we call the dipole moment Q, that is a vector, saying us the direction of the electric or magnetic field. And the norm is nothing but the intensity. Okay, this is the dipolar model, where the problem is that we have an unknown number of sources. So we can work with a small number of sources, because we have, for example, four or at least five active dipoles at each time, but we have to work with an unknown number of sources. The other one, the second model for the brain activity, is the so-called distributed one, where we are considering something like the discretized brain. So each voxel should be a non-null activity, and each voxel has its own dipole moment. Maybe what we will find would be a sparse solution, because we don't imagine that each region of the brain is active at a specific time. So we are looking for a sparse solution. The problem here is that at each time, especially for Monte Carlo models that algorithms are not so fast, here the problem is that we are using a lot of possible locations and a lot of cells that are active at each iteration. So we decided to use the polar model, so the one with an unknown number of sources, and we use the, in order to link the electric field inside the brain with the magnetic field outside, nothing but the Biot-Savart law. That is called the quasi-static approximation of Maxwell equation, so the derivative of the magnetic field in time because of the length of the waves generated by the magnetic field is bigger than the brain. So we can imagine that it's constant. Okay, so the more forward problem, so the magnetic field measured outside, is linked with the position of each dipole and the strength, so the dipole moment, with this simple law, simple forward problem that is linear in the intensity, and non-linear in the dipole locations. and here G is the discretized Biot-Savart law for a current with a unitary dipole moment. Okay, and of course here is written that we use an unknown number of sources because of the dipolar brain activity discretization model. Okay. So we said that the data is the magnetic field measured outside, and we have S sensors, so some sensor outside the brain, and the data are the number of dipoles, the position of each dipole, and the intensity of each one. Okay, and we want to approach, we want to solve this problem in a full Bayesian approach. This means that we want to focus on the posterior distribution, namely the distribution of the unknown, so a possible configuration of dipoles inside the brain, given, so having measured a magnetic field outside. We measure a field and we want to solve the problem of estimating this distribution, the distribution of the possible configurations outside. That by the Bayes law is the prior, so what we know about the unknown, and it's a joke, but we know something about the unknowns. And then the likelihood, that is the probability of having measured the magnetic field, that is what we measure, given a possible configuration inside the brain. And then there is a normalizing constant, but no one cares about that if you don't want to practice something like a model averaging or something similar. Okay, but how can we approximate this posterior distribution instead of, for example, some estimators that are maximum likelihood or maximum posteriori? We can use something like sequential Monte Carlo samplers. It's sequential Monte Carlo algorithm. And in order to explain it, we have to talk a little bit about two Monte Carlo algorithms, that is the important sampling and the metropolis system. The first algorithm is the important sampling here. I'm just introducing this algorithm, but I'm not focusing on it. But as an advertisement, on Thursday I'll be talking about that more in specifically. Okay, so important sampling is an algorithm, a Monte Carlo algorithm, that is focused on the fact that if you want to sample from a distribution, but we are not able to do it, because maybe it's too complex, we can do it from a distribution that here is written as n, where we are able to sample from, and then we have to weight these samples in order to fill the gap between the fact that we are sampling from a distribution that is different from what we want to approximate. It's very simple. So what we get is not a set of particles for what is called a strong law of large numbers, but what we get are weighted particles. In fact, we get each particle that has its own weight. Here, for example, in that simple plot, we see that each point has a marker size that is proportional to the weight. That point that is sampled from n, that is the so-called importance distribution, so where we sampled from, has a high weight, so it's big, because of it's near a place where p, that is our target distribution, has a high probability event. And of course here we get independent samples, because we sample independent samples, particles from a distribution, and we can use the strong law of large numbers in order to get approximation. And of course it's a good thing to have independent samples, because we can parallelize the algorithm. Namely, we can run this algorithm into multiple CPUs, and then put together the results, because each sample is independent from the other. But the fact that we don't learn from the past, it's quite sad, because if a sample is in a high probability region for P, for example, that one or that one, it's not mandatory that the next one will be in a high probability region for P, because each one is independent. Maybe the second one will be there, or in another region. So we want to introduce something that links the past, that don't forget the past. And but we don't want to lose the benefits related with the strong law of large numbers. So the most suitable choice is the so-called Markov chain Monte Carlo. The most common one is Metropolis-Hastings. Where the philosophy is a little bit different. Because here we want to create a Markov chain, so something that depends on the previous step. And at each time we sample from a proposal density that can be seen as an importance density, as an importance sampling, so the one where we are sampling from, but this time it depends on the current state. So, for example, at each time we sample from a Gaussian distribution centered in the actual state, so we move this Gaussian. And we don't really want to create a sequence only sampling from these proposal distributions, so this k, but we want to use an accept and reject scheme. So we propose the move, and then we accept or reject it, depending on what? Depending on if this new state, this new particle, is good enough. Because we don't want to move in bad regions for p, we want to explore the space in a good way. And the most common one is the Metropolis-Hastings, one that is this alpha. And in, what is this? We are proposing x tilde. So we are in xi, yeah, xi, and we want to move, so we propose x tilde. And what is saying this formula? This formula is saying the probability we are, we want to, balance the fact of being in X tilde, so we have some probability of being in X tilde, so the probability of being in X tilde with the probability of moving from X tilde to SRP. With the probability of the inverse, because here we have the probability of being in XI and moving from XI to X tilde. So we want to balance the fact that if we are in X tilde and we move in XI, is the same of moving inverse. And in the case of a symmetric proposal kernel, proposal distribution density, the alpha, so the probability of accepting this move, is nothing but the ratio of the two target densities, the This means that if the proposal point is in a higher place, in a higher has a higher value for p, then the acceptance is certain. Otherwise, we accept with the probability alpha. Okay. So now we've seen the important sampling and the metropolis statistics. Okay. The metropolis statistics, I think that could be useful to see it as a person that is exploring the space with the light. Maybe it should be useful, like we have a map, like in games, and then you move, and each time you find that you discover more and more. And each time you try to do a step, and then you look at if this is a good step or no, would be a problem. Okay, and here, of course, we are referring to Pascal, because we are using Markov chains. Okay, now we are ready to introduce the sequential Monte Carlo samplers. It is something like a merge to the important sampling and entropy statistics. But here we want to approximate at each time a sequence of more and more complex distributions. So we start, so we consider a sequence of densities that starts from a known distribution, an easy one. And then at each time we smoothly change this distribution till the last one, that is the capital T. That is the target distribution. So we are moving from a simple and easy distribution into the target one, with a smooth path. And at each time, we practice a two-step algorithm. At first time, we involve each particle using metropolis statistics. So at each time, with this set of particles, involves using metropolis statistics. And then we modify the problem, so we import these samples from PT, that is the target distribution at time t, into the one at time t plus one. That is more complex and more close and closer to the target distribution. So, with what is called here density mutation. So, we start with this collection of samples that are distributed as P0, that is an easy distribution, a Gaussian distribution. And then we modify this distribution in order to approximate the complex one, the more complex one. And again, as before, like a lot of people with a lot of lights that are exploring this map. And each time the map becomes more and more detailed. Okay, I hope. So, SMC samplers, what is not clear from here, is that SMC samplers are working in increasing dimensional space with time. So at each time we give more and more information, and then the space becomes bigger and bigger. And of course, it's useful for approximating complex distribution, because we are moving through some distribution that becomes more complex and complex. And of course, also in situations where we want to update at each time our target distribution. Because in that, that case, if we have a system that evolves in time, each PT is the distribution of our model at time t. And then at time t plus one, we update it, giving more information. So maybe we are measuring something in time, and then we each time we give the other information, so we modify the target distribution. Here, for example, the posterior distribution. Okay, and in MEG, what are we doing? We are okay. Here you see the sequence, some example of a sequence of distributions where we start from an easy one, that is a so smooth one, and then you modify it until you get the target distribution with two. So we are using a unknown number of sources, so we have to use a more specific metropolis statistics algorithm that is called a reversible jump, where you propose a move in a higher or smaller space. It depends on if you are adding or subtracting some some informations, and some sources. And the Markov chain, that the proposal chain that we are using, is the one that is called the multiple step evolution, where we is the product of the evolution for each unknown. So we evolve at first a number. So we propose, for example, to move from one source into two sources, and then we evolve the position of the current configuration, and then we evolve the double moments of strength of this this configuration. And for what concerns the sequence of distributions, we use the so-called tempering sequence. That is the one that starts from the prior, and then gives more and more weight to the likelihood until, of course, the exponent goes to 1, and then we get the posterior distribution. So we start from the prior, and we modify it until we get the posterior distribution. And, okay, in 2013, Sorrentino and Sommariva proposed this algorithm called SESAME, sequential semi-analytic Monte Carlo estimation, where in the presence of an additive Gaussian noise for the problem that we set a couple of minutes ago for the MEG inverse problem, and with the prior information of a uniform prior in the location, so we don't want to give some information where the dipoles are located, and in the presence of a Poisson distribution for the number of dipoles with a parameter lambda that is less than 1. This means that we prefer configurations in the philosophy of the Occam razor. We prefer a simple configuration. We want to have a small number of dipoles of active sources in the brain. And the fact that was introduced in the sequential semi-analytic Monte Carlo estimation was the prior on the intensity of our dipoles. That is a Gaussian prior. Why? Because I recall you that the intensity was the linear variable of our problem, and if we have a Gaussian prior, we can use the so-called conditionally linear Gaussian approach, or Raoult-Equalized, where we conditioned on the linear variable that now is Gaussian, so this term can be analytically evaluated, and now we have a smaller number of unknown that has to be evolved at each time. At each time we evolve the number and the position of each dipole. Why? With the SMC. While with an analytical approach, we can compute the part of for the posterior, the factor that embodies the intensity. And then with a simple product, we get the full prior, the full posterior, And this, of course, reduces the computational cost for getting the solution using SMC, because we hold less number of variables. And then we can get the posterior as a single product. Okay, but the problem here is that this prior information is not a good prior. It's just a mathematical trick in order to get a more similar problem. Because if we estimate that sigma is the variance of the Gaussian prior, if we estimate the sigma, what does it mean, sigma? Sigma is the strength intensity of each dipole. So if it is too big, then this means that we are using dipoles that are bigger, that has a much strength than the usual, than the true one. So we are trying to explain the data with less number of dipoles. For example, if we have two small dipoles, we try to explain the data with one bigger, and sometimes in the middle of the two. Because we are trying to explain the data with bigger dipoles, while we are, if we are using a too small variance, so if we estimate from the data a variance that is smaller than the true one, we are trying to explain the data with smaller dipoles, so dipoles with less intensity. And for example, here we have types, of course. These are pictures just for listing. How to solve this? We just solve it using a hierarchical model. So we introduced an hyperprior. We introduced an hyperprior on sigma, making it a variable of the problem and evolving it using SMC sampler. In this case, we don't lose the benefits related with the conditional linear Gaussian approach because the problem is still we can still factorize the problem into the product of two terms, one analytically evaluatable and the other one that can be evaluated using SMC, and we get a prior that for the intensity that is no more Gaussian. And it's good because I recall you that the Gaussian prior was not a realistic prior for the intensity of the dipoles. Was only mathematical introduction for simplifying the problem. Okay, and of course it's a generalization. But now the problem is which kind of prior is suitable. So do we know what we don't know about the unknown sigma? We don't really know the order of magnitude. So we would like to use a prior that gives the same probability of different order of magnitude for our parameter. And the one, the most suitable one, is the log uniform distribution or the reciprocal distribution, 1 over x, or 1 over sigma. And this prior gives the same probability of different order of magnitude. This means that if we are not able to estimate properly the parameter, and we don't really know the order of magnitude of this parameter, then this prior is suitable because it's like a uniform in that case. Okay, I just skipped a little bit when I talk about the measurement. Because I said that we measure the electric or the magnetic field outside the scalp, but only in one instant. If we measure, as is usually done, in multiple instants, what we get is something like a lot of measurement at each time interval from 1 to t. And here what we're using is a simplification of the problem, assuming a diagonal covariance matrix for the Gaussian noise. This means that we assume that each interval, at each measurement, at each interval, at each time, is independent. And this turns out to be that the latitude of the measurement made in multiple time intervals is the product of each latitude, because each one is independent. So we can measure the posterior as the prior of this configuration times the product of the latitude. So at each time we give the probability of having measured this particular measurement. These simplifications is something like we are considering dipoles that don't move. The dipole during the time interval considered are fixed in location and number. The only thing that can change, because we analytically evaluate it, is the intensity. So during this time interval, the dipole can, let's say, become bigger and smaller, but they don't move in the brain. We don't are using moving dipoles, but are just fixed dipoles. Okay, now we can relax and just talk a little bit about synthetic data, so some numerical results. The numerical results are on 800 of total data, 400 for the EEG, so the one when where we measure the electric field, and the same for the MEG. We use the number of dipoles that goes from 1 to 4, being sure that two different dipoles are not closer than 3 centimeters, and we've checked on the intensity so that they are measurable outside. And we compared with three different order of magnitude for the estimated parameter. So we estimated the parameter in one order of magnitude less than the true one, the true order of magnitude, and one order of magnitude higher than the true one. So we underestimated the parameter, we estimated in the right way the parameter, we overestimated it, and then we use two different methods for the error estimation. The first one is another error that that is nothing but the difference of the estimated number of dipoles and the other one. And then we use the so-called OSPE error that is here defined, but it's nothing but the minimum distance between the all possible configurations of the true dipoles into the estimated one. So in that case, we measure the all possible distances. It's continuing. Okay, it's a loop. We measure the distances between the estimated dipoles that are the lumen and the true dipoles that is the yellow one, and the OSPE distance is the smaller one, the smallest one. So this is the OSPE. What do we get? here we see the in red, so in the first row, the Sesame algorithm, so the one without the error prior. And in the second row, we see in blue the results, so the confusion matrix for the number of dipoles for the algorithm using the hyper prior. As we can see, and of course by column, we see the underestimation of the parameter, the true estimation for the parameter, and the overestimation for the parameter. So one order of magnitude less, right, and one order of magnitude over. We see that we bound the error prior, so okay, for you, where when we use the smaller, when we use the smaller dipoles, we try to explain the data with a higher number of dipoles. And without the error prior, we are not able to properly estimate the configurations of the dipoles. While using the error prior, we see that we have extremely stability under over under three order of magnitudes for the parameter. With the two estimation of the parameter, everyone. Well, here we see that we try to explain the data with a small number of dipoles. So, as we saw in the slides, some slides. For the OSPE error, we see the same thing. So, the estimated configurations are more far from the true one without using the error prior. So this means that the using the error prior, not only the number of sources is properly estimated, but also the position. In fact, for example, here, with an order of magnitude higher, we see that the distance between the estimated dipoles and the true one without the error prior is about 30 millimeter, while here is so smaller. So we are more sure on the number and also in the position. And I said at the first slide that we are considering it in a full Bayesian approach. So we are considering the full posterior. And what about the posterior variance? Here we see an example of the results obtained with the true estimation of the parameter for the both algorithm for the posterior variance. So how much the algorithm is certain, is peaked around the correct solution. And without the error prior, and here we see the results obtained with one dipoles in the range, two dipoles in the range, and so on. We see that without the error prior, the posterior is not so peaked around the solutions. While using the error prior, the posterior is peaked. This means that the algorithm is more sure that this is the correct solution instead of some other solution. And so, concluding, we saw that in order to solve the Bayesian in the Bayesian approach, the MEG inverse problem, and we saw that we can introduce the hyper prior in the model in order to make it independent for the input parameter sigma, that is the variance of the Gaussian prior for in the dipole moment, that allows us to use a conditionally linear Gaussian approach. And then we saw some variation on numerical results. So thank you for the attention, and I finished.
Thank you for your feedback. but okay. Is there any question with this one? You want to ask something? No? Yeah? Actually, I had a question, but you answered throughout your from the last slide, so I don't know what.
Oh, okay.
it's a good presentation. It's complete, I guess. And so, okay, there are no questions about that. Okay.
Okay.
So,
he can knock.
No. Okay. Just stop me.
Stop. I don't understand why the probability of Q given M and B is...
Is Gaussian?
Yes.
There are a lot of algebra, nothing else. But it's common that... how can I say?
Because
okay, now, one moment. This is the distribution of Q given N and B. So given some configuration, and this depends on the fact that we said that we have a Gaussian noise. This means that also B is Gaussian given R and Q. This is not the answer, but given R and Q, and we have a Gaussian noise, then B is Gaussian. This means that B, so the likelihood, is a Gaussian, okay? And if you want to write down on paper, the conditional distribution of Q, this turns out to be the integral of the likelihood given that, okay? Or something like that. It's just algebra. But yes, it depends on the fact that the likelihood is Gaussian, given a Gaussian additive noise, just translated, and then you marginalize the integral.
So, if there are no other questions. Okay, go to.
Maybe you mentioned it at the beginning, but you always consider a Gaussian distribution as an important sampling distribution.
No. I didn't mention the in, for example, here. No, here. Okay, here. There are three different distributions, importance distribution. These are not importance distribution, but these are proposal distributions. Okay, one moment, sorry. The importance distribution is the one related with the importance sampling. And the importance sampling within the SNC world is the step that moves from some PT, so some distributions in like that one, into the next one. This is the importance. So the weight. Sorry, guys. Okay, that one is pt plus 1 over pt. Because we import from pt into pt plus 1. Okay. What really is important is the choice of the sequence that is sometimes fixed in the Bayesian approach, because it's usual to start from the prior and then move to the posterior. And then you have to choose the proposal kernel, the proposal distribution. That, for example, should be half time you propose a Born, and half time you propose a left, so you use a Bernoulli, or in a position you can use a Gaussian for getting the next position, and for the dipole moment, we don't really use it because we don't involve the dipole moment using the Sesame algorithm, because we evaluate it analytically. I hope to.
Can you go? Yeah. Go. I will stop you. A little bit slow. Can I go?
Yeah.
Okay, now I was looking at the OSPA. This one is... What is this one in the predicted value? So this one looks like the Wasserstein distance between the sampling of the L and earthy.
I don't remember the
definition.
No, it's
this thing here. Okay,
maybe. There are a lot of rebrand.
Of the brand, I know. There's five names only in the machine learning for classification tasks. So, okay, perfect.
The answer is that I said in some slides that the sequential methods like that could be used in situations where you update at each time your posterior, so your information. But in a meanwhile I'll answer you. But in that case we are not considering each distribution at time t as a distribution where we add some information. Here, the B, so the magnetic field, is the entire measurement made in the interval. So, we are not updating in time. We are just using something like you said, so where you use the entire data. But no, I've not tried other methods. And why we can use it? Because we can split into the product, giving the right information that each interval is independent from the other. I don't remember where was the slide, but that it doesn't matter.
You can make it sign to the slide if you can search out the answer if you want.
Yeah, of course, if you want the slide.
No. Yeah,
I think no, but
you can see in that also if you want. Okay, so is there any other question?
Die.
It's time for real. It looks like for real.
Okay.
Okay, so I believe that's all. Thank you again.